Good morning, everybody. Has it been a good morning so far? Hope it will continue to be a good morning. Man lives on hope, so we hope. Thank you, young lady, for the introduction and the welcome address. And my friend, my very good friend of several decades, we know each other, Rajshekaran Pillai, for a wonderful description of me. I was sitting here and thinking, who is he talking about? And I was reminded of that famous Tamil actor who was described like this on a stage one day. He said, Avan naan illai, avan naan illai. I am not the same man that he's describing. I am not the same man that he's described. So today I was feeling like saying, avan naan illai. You know? So anyway, come to the realities today. Madam, Somaiya family members, the trustees, and General Singh Saab, because I respect the soldiers. Because of them, we can sleep comfortably at home. Otherwise, Pakistan would come to our house straight. So thank you very much for being here and being on the trust and guide them very correctly. My wonderful students, whom I love and respect, their teachers, because institutions are not built with brick and mortar and buildings and laboratories. No, they're built with men and women who love to teach and produce very good brains for the future. Now, coming back to the subject today, it's about education. Education is the backbone of every country. You know, when the British wanted to come here, what they planned in the first place is to break the Indian education system, which is our backbone. The Indian education system completely disappeared after that. And they succeeded in their efforts to bring what is called the 18th century English education here. And today, the sophisticated parents, they want to send their children to English education. You know what that 18th century English education is? It came when Britain was having industries coming up. So they wanted some robots who can't think, who should not ask questions, but simply follow what is told. That is the education that we have. That's why Alexis Carrel, a Nobel laureate, once said, every newborn child is a genius, only to be converted into an idiot in school. And I agree with him totally about the Western education, because they make you a robot in the school. See, if you go to school, everybody must be alike. So they try to sort of make you a robot. A for apple. Everybody should say the apple. Supposing you ask a child A for, he will probably say so many things. But it stopped. He should from then on think of only apple, apple, apple. That's called education. No, that's not education. That is just literacy. Most of us are literate, but not educated. And education is to make a human being out of a man or a woman out of a human being. And that is training the mind. Where is the mind? Where is the mind? Here we have a president who is now the head of the mind business. Mind is not in the brain, as we in the medical science used to think. Mind is your consciousness. Mind is everywhere. Mind is universal, and you are a part of that, your individual consciousness. And this mind is the consciousness of man, and that has to be developed. So I always say education must not just be for a wealthy career. Today, you know, I was lecturing in an IIT. I won't tell you which IIT is, one of the IITs. And the director told me, sir, ours is the best IIT in India. I said, on what criterion? He says, our last year's graduates got jobs abroad for 6 to 7 crores a year. I said, if that is your criterion, I am afraid I don't respect your IIT. How many good human beings have you produced? You know, have you heard of a man called Manjunath, an IIT graduate, who did not want to go to America but wanted to join here? So he joined the oil company here, Indian oil company, and found out that a lot of adulteration was going on. So he went to inspect every bunk and found out a lot of adulteration going on in their bunk, and he was shot dead there. This is the kind of people we want. So what we should do in education is to develop the mind, not just a wealthy career. But today, our aim is only to make a career. You ask a parent when the child is going to school, what do you want? I want him to be a doctor. I want him to be an engineer. To earn money, get a big position in society. But nobody says, I want him to be a human being. So my aim of education should be in the future to make a healthy mind. What is a healthy mind? A healthy mind is a mind filled with enthusiasm to work. How many of us really have enthusiasm to work? Tell me. I don't think even 1% of Indians have enthusiasm to work. What is enthusiasm to work? You must have that provocation to work. Enthusiasm is a very nice word in Latin. En means inside. Theos is God. So God sits inside and provokes you. Prachodayat, that's what the young lady so beautifully sang. Prachodayat, we get up in the morning and say, Prachodayat, give me provocation to you, make me a good human being. And that is called education. So unfortunately, we don't do that. We should be aiming at making a healthy mind. And the other important part of healthy mind is an enthusiasm to be compassionate. See, if all of us are compassionate, where there is a problem in the society, no conflict, no fights, no terrorism, none of those things will be there. And we don't even need an army. Today, every country spends so much money on its army because without the army, the country will be wiped off. So all that is because we don't have compassion. And two things that a healthy mind should have is enthusiasm to work and enthusiasm to be compassionate. And that is the aim of life should be. Actually, they were trying to find out what is life, what is health, etc., etc. And you must have heard about risk factors, high blood pressure, fat, cholesterol, and sugar and all. None of those things matter. In a long study of 75 years observation of the Harvard alumni of the 1930s, the sophomores of the 1930s, till to date, they found a lot of them have died. It's 90 years now. Few of them are. But what came out of the study was very important thing, which India knew for thousands of years ago in Ayurveda. Aptopasevi bhavet arogyam. If you love everyone in this world, you will be healthy and living long. And that's what Ayurveda says. Aptopasevi bhavet arogyam. And that's exactly what this study showed. Study showed three things. A, drinking alcohol is your enemy number one. Two, smoking cigarette is your enemy number two. And what's your friend? Compassion. Love everyone. And the more number of friends you have, more number of people you like, more number of family members you like, and more number of people in the society you like and want to be compassionate, you will live long and healthy life. That's exactly what Ayurveda has been saying for 5,000 years. Aptopasevi bhavet arogyam. So friends, just develop a mind with compassion, develop a mind with enthusiasm to work. And working is very important because that's another very important feature for good health. Samikshakari says Ayurveda. Samikshakaris work very hard. I have not seen anybody dying of hard work. Though of course people say don't work very hard, you get tired and things like that. Your own parents will say get tired and things like that. As a matter of fact, the whole science of stress started with a young boy in Canada. He was about 17 years old. He wanted to read the whole day and night. So his old grandmother said, don't read too much, you will become mad. So this boy said, I love to read, and why is my grandmother saying that? So he said, what is stress? So he started in 1936, he wrote a letter to the scientists in America, what is stress? And he didn't get a reply. By 1956, he produced a huge data on stress and he wrote an encyclopedia of stress called, his name was Hans Selye. You have the book called Encyclopedia of Stress by Hans Selye. Don't read that, it's too much for you. But read a smaller book he has written for you, Stress and Distress. Stress is an integral part of life. If you don't have stress, you'd wither away and die in no time. Supposing you say, I don't want any stress, I want to sit in the Himalayas and meditate, you will not be there after 1 week. Stress is a must. Stress is a part of life. But distress is bad. Distress is bending abnormally against stress. This is what most of us do. You know, you get a headache in the evening. A lot of people say they get a headache in the evening. Do you know why? They are so tense when they are whole day. And when you are very tense in the day, your neck muscles tense up. And when the neck muscles tense up, your huge muscle that starts in the forehead, goes to the neck, is called occipital frontalis muscle, that becomes tense. So you get headache in the evening. So if somebody comes and tells me, I have a headache, I tell them, no, you don't have a headache, you are a headache. So people say, I have a neck pain. I say, no, you are a pain in the neck. And if you are a pain in the neck, you have a headache, you have a neck pain. So if you are not a pain in the neck, nothing will happen. So what is the end of the day? You must be a very good human being. If you are a good human being, you are a good educated person. How to be a good human being? A, you must work very hard. B, you must love everyone in this world. Love is not, now younger generation should not take the word love for lust, that is the usual meaning. No. Love is compassion, C-O-M-P-A-S-S-I-O-N. You just universal compassion. You like everything. Sarva Bhuta Priti in Sanskrit. Sarva Bhuta. All life you love. So it's not just only man, animals, everyone you love. And if you did that, you will have no tension. You will not have headache. You will not have neck ache. And you will be a human being. And that should be the aim of education. Are we trying to do that? I don't think so. We are trying only to have a career for you. You must have a career at the end of the day. You must be a BA and get a teacher's job. You must be a B.Ed. and get a teaching job. You must be a doctor and do what doctors do now. They shouldn't be doing what they are doing now. As Rajshekhar Pillai was reminding me that I wrote an article many times ago that when doctors go on strike, society becomes healthier. Because we intervene too much. You know, whenever you go to a doctor, I just want to do something. So if I don't do anything, that's the American thing. Fix it, do it. Actually, if you leave it alone, every disease, mark my words, every disease from common cold to cancer will either cure itself or kill you. One of the two things. And doctor's intervention only hastens that, but doesn't do anything else. No doctor can take you, as the common in newspaper says, he was pulled from the jaws of death by a doctor. It's bullshit. Nobody can pull you anything from the jaws of death. If you're dying, you're going to die. And doctors can only help. And Hippocrates said, our father of modern medicine said, cure rarely, comma, comfort mostly, comma, but console always. You should be able to console. But what do we do today? The reverse. The minute you go there, it says, oh my God, you got a cancer. You may live only for 6 months. How on earth does that doctor know that you will live for 6 months? Because we doctors cannot predict the future of our patients. Nobody knows, nobody can predict the future, including the astrologers. Because the future doesn't exist in quantum physics. Tomorrow is not born. Tomorrow is yet to be born. How do you know what happens tomorrow? You don't know whether tomorrow is going to happen at all. So future predictions are not possible. There's a beautiful study in the British Medical Journal called Doctors Predicting the Unpredictable Future of Their Patients. You go to a doctor and say, doctor, I have a fever. I have a lecture in Somaiya College tomorrow. It must come down tomorrow. He said, don't worry. Take this tablet 3 times a day and your fever will go. Doctor doesn't know what your fever is due to. Doctor doesn't know what the tablet does. Doctor doesn't know whether you will go to Somaiya's College or not. But he'll predict it. So, but that prediction itself is not based on science. It's based on hearsay. Because science can never predict. You see the weather predictions. Have you seen the weather prediction in Bombay yesterday? It's going to rain today. It's raining outside, isn't it? It won't rain. Predicting the unpredictable future is what we all do. So then the education must not just aim at a healthy sort of wealthy career. Of course, wealthy career is a must, which will come. A wealthy career will come if you are a good human being, irrespective of where you are and what you are. Because money, you don't have to go after money. Money will come after you when you're a good human being. So you don't have to worry about that. But you must train yourself to have a healthy mind. Remember that. The mind must be trained first to be a healthy mind. And that's why I like. See, for example, I saw you're saying somewhere, knowledge is power. This is what the British said. Knowledge is power. Knowledge is not power. Wisdom is power. Knowledge is some information. You know, you can get knowledge. Knowledge is second hand. I have so much of knowledge. Goethe said, I now know physiology, philosophy, jurisprudence, even theology from end to end with labor skin. But here I stand, O fool, with all my lore, no wiser than before. Whether you become wiser or not is a question. Knowledge accumulates, but wisdom comes. Knowledge dwells in heads replete with thoughts of other men. He said, I have read so many books. So many people are very proud of having read so many books. I will say, I have never read any books. I have, right from my younger days, I used to think. Anything that comes to my mind, I used to think about it, dissect it, study it, and try to understand and get something comes out of my mind. And wisdom dwells in heads attentive to their own. Knowledge and wisdom, far from being one, have nothing in common, said the poet. Because knowledge is something which comes and goes. Wisdom is something which lingers. And wisdom is your own. And that's your generation. That's why I ask students, ask questions. And I always say, if a teacher in the class cannot answer all the questions, she or he is an evolved teacher. I would love a teacher when once he or she says, I don't know. Because when you come to the stage to say, I don't know, you are a wise man. When you say, I know everything, you are an idiot. Because you know nothing. But wisdom comes and wisdom lingers. And wisdom is very important. I always say, educational institutions must have the dictum, wisdom is power, not knowledge is not power. Wisdom is power. And wisdom must be something that we must develop. And wisdom comes from your own head, your own mind, and that must be encouraged. And that's exactly the future aim of education. Now, unfortunately, what happens today? Our educational standard is so low. Our education is only for higher education. And the whole country is corrupt. You take any area. Who is not corrupt? Tell me. How can you be corrupt if you had a good education? If you had a good education and you say, I must work very hard and I must be compassionate, how can you be corrupt? When once you say, I must make more money than the other person, this comparison, because it starts in the school. That's why he said, when you go to school, you become an idiot. What is that first say? He is first rank, second rank. What is first rank, second rank? Comparing with others. Competing with others is mediocrity. Competing with yourself is excellence. So you teach a child to compete with itself. It must be a better child tomorrow than what it is today. Not that it is better than another child. That is very bad. When the child goes home, the mother says, you're first rank, bash. The second child goes home and says, why didn't you see? Look at that Somaiya's child is first rank. You are second rank, you are no good. The child becomes no good after that. Never tell a child you are no good, because it's only positive thoughts must be put into the child. And then only the child will grow. So what is important is you must always encourage. I always tell in educational institutions, a child must get a medal if he or she has improved from 35% mark when he came in to 75 marks. Not 72.7% compared to another 76%. That's no good. That is mediocrity. We are encouraging mediocrity in our educational system. We should encourage excellence. Make every child compete with itself. And when once you compete with yourself, you know the negative thoughts. When I compete with others, now a lot of negative thoughts. All the negative thoughts enter when once you go to school. Till that time, the child was very, very happy. And as a matter of fact, you can make out from a child's heart. Child's heart is very, very healthy. It takes breaths. When the child breathes in, the heart goes fast. When the child breathes out, it goes slow. This is called heart rate variability. In other words, the heart rate is connected to the mind. When the child breathes in, heart goes faster. When the child breathes out, heart goes slower. As you grow older and start getting all the negative thoughts and start hating people, etc., etc., then this variability goes. And you reach a stage where the heart is never variable. It's the same when you breathe in or breathe out. Your death is very close. So you are becoming more and more of a inhuman human being as you grow. Education must make you a human being, not inhuman human being. And we have to change our educational system in such a way that we should see that educational system itself inculcates self-competition, competition with oneself. Supposing I compete with myself and try to be a better human being tomorrow than what I am today, who do I hate? I don't have to hate nobody. So that's where healthy mind comes, and healthy mind comes with self-competition. Without competition, you will die. You must have competition, but not competing with others. Trying to say, I am a best teacher in the college. No, I am a better teacher today than what I was yesterday. That should be the ideal way to look at. And that's called making a healthy mind. And this is why I always say, education must aim at making a healthy mind, not just a wealthy career. And this is the idea of talking to you today, because I thought you're all educationists, either teachers or educational institution owners. And today, of course, educationist one who amasses wealth by the bad means and then starts an educational institution, he's called an educationist. And immediately he gets a honorary doctorate and he calls himself a doctor. And this honorary doctorate doesn't mean anything. Today I'm told you can buy a honorary doctorate also by paying money to some universities, not all. Some governors are looking for money so that they have so many universities under them. They'll say, you give me 2 crores, I'll get you an honorary doctorate from A university or B university. Because recently, one of the vice chancellors of Mangalore University, who was an old student of mine, called me and said, sir, I am having trouble, sir. I said, what? Our governor has taken money from some really bad people and wants me to give them an honorary doctorate. And I am troubled. I said, get lost. Leave your job and go. Why do you want to hang on there? You know, if you want to hang on to the system like that, you have to be a part of it. If you don't want, you get out. The best way is to get out and get going. And this is unfortunate. And this is where education has come to. In short, education has come to making money, either making money or trying to make money for others. Some of you may not be corrupt, but you make others corrupt under your tutelage. So all that should stop when a mind develops into a higher level. And when the mind develops into a higher level, you become a human being. And that's where our educational system was. Our Gurukula system of education was such that there they never used to compare two students. They used to compete with yourself. Our teachers used to make us compete with ourselves. I still remember the days when we were students, when I was a student about nearly half a century ago, or little over that. Our teachers never said, you become the first rank. They said, you improve tomorrow from today. And I still remember my headmaster calling me and saying, okay, you are now much better than what you were. And I appreciate that. Because I was not good in mathematics. And that's why I became a doctor. If I were very good in mathematics, I would have become an engineer. But my headmaster said, no, now you are good in mathematics, you can become an engineer also. But I had made up my mind to become a doctor, so I just became a doctor. I think I had chosen the wrong profession. And when my son came up and said, Daddy, I don't want to be a doctor like you, I said, fine. So he became an engineer. I appreciate that. And never impose your will on your children. This is another thing that we do in education. The father wants the son to be a doctor, so he sends him to the medical school. I have written an article, if you want to, it's in the internet, you read. Want to be a doctor, comma, think before you jump. Because if you're not having an aptitude to be a doctor, you're unfit to be a doctor and a danger to society if you're a doctor. First, find out if you're a doctor. I suggest students who want to be doctors to work as an aya or a ward boy in a hospital after your PUC for about 2 weeks and see how people suffer. Because a lot of students come and tell you, sir, this is a very interesting case for clinics. What is interesting, he's a 16-year-old boy of the age of the student himself, having 4 valve disease in the heart and imminent, he's dying in another few months' time. And he's interesting for this fellow. And that's the unfortunate thing that we have in our educational system. I say, no, he's an unfortunate human being. You have little empathy, you put yourself in his bed and think for yourself. Your future is just a few months. And then you are here for the benefit of the students, and the students come and tap you morning to evening. You know, we doctors have become so inhuman now. We don't even bother, because I lost an army officer next door to me. I still remember that, just 2 weeks ago. This man was walking on the road, 3 students in one bike without any license. They came from the wrong side, hit him, and he fell down. And when he fell down, he hit the head, so he became unconscious. So immediately transported to an ICU of an intensive care unit of a very big 5-star hospital. Per day, they were spending about 50,000 to 1 lakh of rupees. But this man had injured his chest in the bargain. When he fell down, his chest got injured. The ribs went in and fractured the lung, and the lung was collapsed. But nobody examined him. They just said, he's unconscious, so take a CAT scan, dog scan, and a PET scan, and all kinds of scans were taken. And they went on treating his head injury, but never even bothered to examine him and touch his chest. And this man died. And on postmortem, we found the death was due to the chest injury and not due to the head injury. This is very unfortunate. But then, you know, this is what we do. I always say, you go to a doctor today, nobody examines you. They simply write tests. By the time you say head, all the head scans are written. By say chest, all the chest things are written. And this is where the problem comes. A very prominent doctor, very senior doctor in Madras wanted to see me one day. He called me and said, sir, I want to consult you. I said, okay, come along. So he came with a big file, thick file. He said, sir, I went to Singapore General Hospital and this is my file. So treat me. I said, if I read that file and treat you, I'll have to treat you what they treated you with. I want to examine you. Sir, you want to examine me? Nobody has examined me, he said. I said, no, I want to examine you, because I was taught when I was a student that you must first clinically examine a patient, come to a conclusion, and do 1 or 2 tests to either refute it or confirm it. So he reluctantly removed his shirt and lied down on the table. Then I went and examined him for about 30 minutes and came to some conclusion which was different from what that file had shown. He got better. He was on 28 tablets. I gave him only 2 tablets. And he went home and told his wife, that man examined me like a third-year medical student. She was also a doctor. She said, then that's the right way to do it. And that's how it happened. So today we have lost that being a doctor is being compassionate. And being a doctor, you know, a lot of people have a fight whether you should take English medicine or Ayurvedic medicine. There is no caste system in medicine. There's nothing called English medicine or Ayurvedic medicine. They're all medicines. That's all. They all come from the same source, either from vegetables or from animals. And they are all same. They are refined. A little more refined in the Western medicine, a little more crude in the Eastern medicine. That's all the difference. Like, for example, I still remember when I was a student, for the heart failure, we used to use the leaves of Digitalis lanata, a plant. And we used to have powder lanata, and we used to give it crude, but large dose, small dose is all right. Today, we have a refined digoxin tablet in the Western. A little extra dose, a man may die. A little less dose, it's not effective. So the therapeutic and the killer dose were very close to each other. In the Western system, that's the curse of medicine. More people die because of our medicines than probably without them. Adverse drug reactions, ADR, is the commonest cause of death in the hospitals today. And we, you know, you won't be surprised if you see the prescriptions, this laundry list of prescriptions. Every doctor who comes to see, because the specialist is one who knows more and more about less and less, until he comes to a stage where he knows more and more about nothing. And you see, head specialist gives head medicines. The leg specialist gives leg medicines. So total medicines will be 28. I saw one lady in Chennai the other day, mother of a very prominent family in Chennai. If I told you, you'll know who they are. Very prominent people. So the son came and said, "Sir, please, for my mother's sake, please come home and see her." I normally don't go. Anyway, I went. I saw this lady in a large air-conditioned room where the windows are not opened for donkey's ears. And she's sitting there, and the room was like Himalaya, so cold. And she was sitting in a large bed, never seen outside. And she was taking about 28 tablets. So I examined her and told the son, first thing is put all the tablets into the waste paper basket. Then I said, open all the windows and put her outside in the sun for 1 hour. You will be surprised. The lady who was not able to get out of bed is now able to walk to the music academy in Chennai. And she is very happy with only just one or two tablets. But sunlight. Sunlight is the best medicine. And probably what is important is water is the next medicine. And there is a nice saying, you know, a lot of people say, Vaidyo Narayana Hari, doctor is God. Nobody said that. Do you know what it said? Sharire jarjari bhute vyadigraste vaidyo narayano hari and toyam janaviya toyam. As you know, when you are very seriously ill and about to die, your best doctor is God himself and the best medicine is Gangajal. Both are true. Even today in 2018, that sloka is absolutely true. And no, vaidyo narayano hari is not, you are not called God. God is the best doctor, which is true. Because you know, even today, I always say, you pray to God even if you go to your best doctor, because without praying to God, the doctor will send you to heaven or hell without knowing where to send you. And I always console my patients, don't worry. The people are terribly worried about dying. So I console them. Why worry? Death you must know. Everybody has to die. That's why you're aiming at dharma, artha, kama, moksha. Of course, now if you go into Advaita, you can get moksha in this life itself. It's called Jivan Mukti. But if you don't, you die and go to moksha. And where do you go? Either you go to hell or heaven. Well, you are a good man. Your account is very good. So you must go to heaven. So if you go to heaven, that's where you wanted to go all your life. So you're happy. Perchance, God has not kept the account book correctly. And you go to hell. So what? So many of your friends are there. You're happy there. So in either case, you are happy. So you're happy. Why worry? So not worry. And not worrying is one of the ways of getting your diseases cured. So you keep quiet when you have a disease and the disease will go. And if it doesn't go, then you see a doctor. Don't see the doctor on the first day itself. That's a dangerous thing to do. Take your time, relax and see if the disease can go. And when once you relax, you will be surprised to see most diseases disappear, simply disappear. So it is the tension that goes with the disease that kills and not the disease itself, because many diseases don't kill. They all eventually go. So friends, education must make you understand the other man's problem, which is very difficult. That's called compassion. Compassion is trying to understand another man's problem. That's called empathizing. Sympathy all of us have. You know, you see an accident on the road, you go, you say, my God, oh my. You're sympathizing with them, but not doing anything. But if you have empathy, if you have compassion, you just stop your car there, get out and see what you can do for that man. or take him to the nearest hospital, which rarely people do. And that's the level of education we must try to achieve in this country. Back to our old educational system, which the British destroyed totally. And we don't want this British system of education, because the British system of education is only to give you a degree at the end of the day and get you a job. The Indian system of education is to transform you, a human being, into either a man or a woman, whoever you are. Because man is, in that true sense of the word, is a human being who is really good. Woman is another human being who is really good. So that should be the aim of education. And don't you think we should aim at that rather than just getting a degree? At the end of the day, if you get a degree and a job, what good is it? Everybody does that. As I always say, who doesn't look after the wife and children? Even the dog looks after. But as a human being, you must do something for society. And as Rajshekaran Pillai rightly said, when I do something for society, it is a rent I pay for being here. Now, you see, you called me here, and I am giving you a lecture. Some of you clap, some of you will go and say, what that ass was talking, I don't know what he was talking. But one thing is, you have called me here because I am somebody, you recognize me as somebody in society. It is society that has given me the status. And what do I do for society? I must do something in return. And that's why I'm here. I'm very happy I'm here, because the Somaiya Institutes are doing a lot of good things for education. And I hope they'll continue to do good things. And I've heard a lot from Rajshekaran Pillai about what the Somaiya Institute does, Somaiya Institutes take. And I'm told, and this is the most important thing, they don't take even a penny as donation for any course, starting from class 1 to the highest class that you have in your course. And that's something great. But I tell you, this kind of institutions are a must, because in the next 50 years, Indian population will be 70% below the age of 30 years, which means 700 to 800 million young boys and girls would be wanting higher education, which government cannot provide. We must have private institutions. But what kind of private institutions? Somaiya like private institutions, not private institutions built to make money. And you must have institutions with the responsibility. And these are the institutions which the government must eventually fund, because institutions cannot sustain themselves if they don't take money from the students. You may say, okay, Harvard and Stanford. What do they do in Harvard and Stanford? You think Harvard and Stanford exist because of the government funding? No. And it's because either the alumni or society funds it. And even there's so much of bad things happening. You would be surprised. A survey showed that most of these large universities, they don't really do what they ought to do. The teachers are corrupt. Teachers take money from industries, from research grants, etc., etc. So science today has become, one who gets more grant becomes a bigger scientist. His science is now tied to money. Everything is money-oriented. There's a nice book written by one of my friends in Cambridge called Science Set Free. You see that book? It's a very nice book. Science Set Free. And when you see that book, you know how science is under the clutches of money. If you don't get a grant, you're not considered a scientist. If you get grant, you have to please the grant giver. So write a wrong data. Like, for example, you all felt that fat is the cause of heart disease, right? And some of you don't even look at fat when you sit in the dining table. You close your eyes when you see butter. But the whole thing originated from a false study. It's a man called Ansel Case, who was given about $100 million from the American government for finding out the disease, the relationship between fat and heart disease. So he went around. He took his wife, who was a biochemist, and between the two of them, they had a honeymoon in 22 countries and collected data. And when they went and plotted it, they found that there was no correlation between the two. So what did he do? He can't give a negative data because he has got money from the government. He has to give a positive data. So he sat at night, eliminated country by country by country by country, and was left with 7 countries. It's called Ansel Case 7 Country Study. These 7 countries did not include many of the countries where there are a lot of fat eating but no heart disease at all, like Norway, Sweden and all. But he included countries like USA, England, Germany and all, where people eating fat had higher heart disease, or that's what they thought. Again here, the wrong science. This is just association. When two things go up in society, the two are connected. The two are associated, but they are not causality. One is not the cause of the other. Like, for example, since Second World War in Europe, affluence went up. So people ate more food, People bought more trousers. People did so many things more. But everything is connected to higher death rate since Second World War. So somebody wrote a paper saying that death rate goes up because of fat intake. Another person thought death rate goes up due to sugar intake. The third person wrote death rate goes up due to trouser buying, because if you buy more trousers, you get more heart attack. So this is only association, and association is made into causality. Causality is something different. One is not the cause of the other. One is just an association of the other. So all this kind of science creeps in because we have not had really ethics in education. We have not trained our mind to be ethical. And we never thought, what are we putting down in the public domain? Is it the truth? The whole truth, but nothing but the truth. No, it is a truth at a given time, which when B truth comes, gets replaced. So you're not giving the society the truth. The truth is almost evanescent. That's why when the truth comes, it's called naked truth. Do you know why it's called naked truth? Truth and lie were friends, I believe, in the good old days. So they went for a walk one day and saw a beautiful lake. So they said, why not we take a bath in this lake? So both of them got in, put their dresses outside, dipped into the lake. And they were swimming for a long time. So lie quietly slipped out of the tank, came out and put on the truth's clothing and went for a walk and went around the world. When truth came out, eventually it didn't have clothes. So it went for a walk naked. And truth takes a long time to walk. So lie goes down respectably because it has got the cover of the truth. So every lie is thought to be truth, which it is not. And truth is naked. When you see a naked truth, you are shocked. You know, that's why it's called a naked truth. Did you understand that? That's exactly what happens in society. While truth takes a long time, Churchill said, when truth has no time even to pull up its pants, lies and mystery have taken two and a half rounds of the world. And that's exactly what happens. You put a wrong thing in society, it goes around very fast. That too in today's, what's called social media, with this IT and things like that, and computer, it goes around so fast. But the truth never travels. It doesn't go, because it's still naked and can't expose itself. So that's how society runs. All because of one thing, the wrong educational basis. Education being just aimed at making a career and not aimed at making a healthy mind. So let's make the mind healthy. You know, as I was telling in the beginning, we don't know where the mind is. We think the mind is in the brain. A lot of people even today think the mind is in the brain. As a matter of fact, when somebody has a mental disorder, what do? We give chemicals. Where do the chemicals go? They go to an organ, only the brain, and damage the brain. So if you take chemical drugs for a mental disease, your brain gets damaged, so you get eventually dementia, which is called Alzheimer's disease. And there's a psychiatry professor in New York, she wrote a book that we, the psychiatrists, damage the brain of patients. So she wrote a book called Dementia, drug-induced crime by doctors. This book cost her job. So she was dismissed as a professor of psychology in the New York University psychiatry. But she said, okay, I don't mind. And this book gets her now enough money, millions of dollars, to survive. And her name is Grace Elizabeth Jackson. Just see the book. It's a beautiful book called The Mind is the Most Important Thing, and the Mind is Not in the Brain. And that's where the drugs that we give for patients damage our brain. And she said dementia or depression or dementia or mental depression or what's called Alzheimer's disease is a drug-induced crime on mankind by doctors. So you should be very careful. And what does a mind disease require? Another good mind. As a psychologist, I was very happy that today's president is a psychologist and counseling psychologist, because counseling psychologists can treat a lot of unhealthy minds. So I always tell people, if you have an unhealthy mind, you require another healthy mind to make you sensible. I have a granddaughter who is a PhD in counseling psychology from Berkeley University. And she does counseling of cancer children. And she's very happy because a lot of these cancer children with cancer, because they are not counseled, they die because of the fear of disease itself. And if you counsel them, they live long. And all that is needed is good counseling. And that's because you require a healthy mind to cater to another unhealthy mind. So we require a lot of few people properly trained in the Somaiya institutions to cater to the unhealthy minds in society. So I wish you good luck, Godspeed, and thank you once again for inviting me here. And I don't know what you will say when you go home. I had a friend of mine who used to go around lecturing all over the place, and one day he came to Bombay to lecture. And his lecture was in a hall near the fort, but he didn't know where the hall was. So he got out in the morning, being a Sunday, he wanted to write a letter to his wife at home. So he wrote a letter, went out and looked around. There were children playing on the roadside. So he said, "Hey, where is the post office children here?" So they took him. He said, "Come along, sir, we are free today. We'll take you to the post office." They took him to the post office. So he posted a letter on his way back. Because he had a good education, he said, "I must do something for these children who helped me." So he wanted to buy some chocolate. So he went to the shop and tried to put his wallet. It was in the room. So he told the children, "My dear children, I'm sorry, I don't have money to buy you chocolate. But today I'm giving a speech in the evening. It's 100 rupees per seat. So you'd give this chit to the organizer. And then she'll be allowed free. So you save 100 rupees for helping me." Children laughed. He said, "Why are you laughing?" "No, sir. No, I don't get angry because I'm a very important man. I never get angry. I'm very happy." So children said, "You want to know, sir?" "Certainly, yes. A man who did not know the way to the post office, how is he talking about way to heaven and things like that in the evening?" So you will say, "This man didn't know the way to heaven and he was talking about education." So thank you very much for doing that. And thank you very much once again for listening to me. And thank you, Rashekan Pille, for inviting me here. And thank the Somaiya institutions for hosting me. Thank you all very, very much once again. Good night. Good luck. Goodbye. Questions are welcome. You can ask questions. But I can't guarantee that I'll give you an answer. Questions are welcome. Sardar ji, theek hai? If General Singh says it's theek hai, it's theek hai.
So my name is Aditya Rao.
Aditya Rao.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
And I wanted to ask you that. I went to a international school for a demo lecture, and I started teaching trigonometry over there. I was giving the demo in front of teachers only. There were no students. So the teacher asked me that students here are like, "I want to be a lawyer. Why should I learn trigonometry?" So how do I mean...
No, I didn't get that.
No, actually, teacher said that students are like, I want to be a lawyer, not a mathematician. So why should I learn maths? Why should I learn trigonometry? So how do I face such situations?
To be a good lawyer, you must know a little bit of everything. So you better learn some mathematics, some trigonometry. Otherwise, when you have a case in the court, if the mathematics is involved in it, you'll be an idiot and you'll not be able to argue. So education must be a little more broad-based.
Afternoon, sir. My name is Mohit Shetty. And many a times we have to set our timetable with respect to work or prior commitments. And I used to have a habit of sleeping at 10 or 11. But after the student life started, I can't sleep till 1 o'clock. The thoughts clutter my mind. And it means life is going on becoming more and more unhealthier compared to previous times when work was less.
No. You think if you sleep late is unhealthy?
Yes.
No. Yes. How long do you think you should sleep?
6 to 7.
6 to 7. Who told you that? No. I'm seriously asking you. Because we are all told that you have to have sleep for 6 to 7, 8 hours. Do you know who started this? The sleeping pill industry. Actually, some people sleep only for 1 to 2 hours. They are very healthy. Some people sleep for 8 to 9 hours, they're healthy. But those who sleep beyond 7 hours, they're unhealthy because your muscles degenerate. So you don't require, some people, I have a lot of my patients who don't even sleep. Nothing happens to them. I have a student of mine who is a very prominent neurosurgeon. He tells me, "Sir, I sleep for 1 hour every night." And he'll be operating at 1 o'clock in the morning or 2 o'clock in the morning, but he'll be sleeping for 1 hour and getting up and again operating. He's very healthy. He's quite healthy. He's about 55. And touch wood, he's very healthy. Nothing happens. So sleeping late doesn't mean anything. But You think it's okay, but you don't have to read unnecessarily too much. I still remember, as a student, I have never slept beyond. I have never slept after 9 o'clock. I always sleep at 9 o'clock, and I get up at about 4 o'clock, of course, because morning is a very nice time. No galata at all at that time. You can read, you can concentrate, you can do your work. Even now, I get up early and go to sleep early. I now go to sleep even earlier. See, in the good old days, when light was not there, Thomas Alva Edison was not born. So, we went by the sun. So, our ancestors, they slept when the sun set and they woke up when the sun rose. But otherwise, night was just dark. So, they slept as soon as the sun set. They slept as soon as the sun came down and then slept for about 4 hours. Then they woke up. Then they had their food in the night or other things that people do at night. And then again slept for another 4 hours. So, they used to sleep four hours. And today also, you sleep, but 4 hours later you wake up and then again try to sleep. So if you have a 4 hour sleep, it's enough. So don't worry, you're very healthy.
Thank you.
Shetra, correct, huh?
Yes, sir, correct.
Pale.
Sir, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I am Colonel Gopi Krishnan. I just...
Colonel, you are a colonel.
Yeah, I am a serving
colonel.
I salute you. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. I am humbled. I
respect all army officers.
Sir, thank you so much. I just jumped into this lecture. I heard that you are giving a public lecture here. So I just came to listen to you, sir. And I saw the topic, which is very interesting.
Now you feel it's been a waste of time.
No, sir. I am very convinced I did the right thing. I just saw the topic, the aim of education, wealthy career or healthy mind. So is it compulsorily supposed to be a choice between the two? Can the aim of education be both wealthy career and healthy mind?
No, both, yes. That's why I said and or. But the most important thing is a healthy mind, not just a wealthy career. Because today our education is like the British education, only for wealthy career. That's why where we are. Now you see, we all want to be rich, you know. Because that's the Western education idea. Now, supposing you're all IAS officers. Every IAS officer gets the same pay. So how can you be best IAS officer among them? So your wife says, you know, look at the lady next door. She's also an IAS officer's wife. She has nice saris I don't have. And then he says, okay, I'll also be corrupt. So corruption comes in because the unhealthy mind.
Agreed.
If you have a healthy mind, you'll never be corrupt. So to avoid corruption, which is the bane of Indian society, we must change our education system.
Thank you, sir.
You agree?
I definitely agree, sir. Thank you.
Good man.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Sir, here. In front of you. Here.
Oh, yes. Yes.
Sir, I have been religiously listening to you on your YouTube videos and I regularly follow you.
Okay.
Sir, my question is, if someone wants to have a profession for which they are compassionate, they have the qualities for it, but due to some circumstances, their marks or some aptitude doesn't let them be have that profession. So what should a person do? Should they give it up or should they still pursue it?
No, if possible, you pursue that. If it is impossible, then change it. You know, I always say, you love what you do or do what you love. Supposing you can't do what you love what you do.
Sir, my problem is that I think I would love what the profession has to offer, but I don't love studying. The problem is that I
didn't get the last part of the sentence.
I don't like to study, but yes. I think I would love what the profession has to offer in the future. So that is my concern.
Go on. What is wrong?
But
why is it studies
is the main problem.
Oh, study is the problem. Without study also, you can get into the same profession.
Sir, what if someone wanted to be a doctor, but they were not good at studies?
You want to be a doctor?
I wanted to be a doctor.
You wanted to be a doctor?
Yes.
Why? Even now you can be a doctor. You can change it and go to the medical school now. What is wrong? Nothing is wrong.
The eligibility criteria and all that's pulling me back.
Get into other system. Go to the Ayurvedic college. They'll take you. You become a doctor. What's it? Don't have any holier than the attitude towards Ayurveda. Ayurveda is very holy science. As a matter of fact, it is much better than Western science.
Yes, sir. Agree.
But unfortunately, even the so-called educated people have a low opinion about Ayurveda. I was lecturing in another IIT, actually IIT Mumbai. And I was talking about various things in the medical field and incidentally mentioned Ayurveda as a science. So one professor, senior professor, got up and said, I liked your lecture, but you know, I hate you because you say Ayurveda is science. Then I told him, I'm sorry, sir. A person who doesn't know what Ayurveda is still a professor in IIT. I have a very low opinion about the IIT, I told him. Okay?
Okay, thank you, sir.
So, good luck. You become a good doctor.
Thank you, sir.
And if you still don't succeed, take homeopathy. No, homeopathy is a great science. Homeopathy is a science of energy. Yeah. And homeopathy is not hocus pocus or placebo. As a matter of fact, everything is placebo. Everything. Even Western medicine is placebo only. It all works on faith. Yes. If you think that the medicine works, it works. If you think that the medicine doesn't work, it doesn't work.
Thank you so much, sir.
Actually, they did a study in Oxford. They gave a drip of morphia, which is the best painkiller, to patients with severe cancer pain, and told the patient while giving the thing, this is not morphine. This is just a new vitamin we have found. It will not relieve your pain. No patient got pain relief with the morphia running intravenously. Remember that? Then they took him to the other side called crossover study. They started saline drip, salt water, and told the patient, this is morphia, and your pain will go. 98% of the pain went. So it's all in the mind. Then they were surprised as to what they're saying. So they did an fMRI, you know, MRI of the brain, functional MRI of the brain while they're doing the study. And what they found was, during when the patient believed, remember the word believed that it is morphine, the forebrain produced so much of opioids that the pain went off. When the patient did not believe that it's morphine, the brain slept and nothing happened. So ultimately, the relief comes from your own system, from your own immune system, not from others. And that's the belief. And I'll give you a book you read called Timeless Healing by a man called Herbert Benson in Harvard. And Timeless Healing tells you that all healing is belief. Even to the extent surgery is belief. Probably you think, you know, what is he talking about? They're cutting the patient. It's belief. They did a bypass surgery by just cutting the skin and then said, we have done bypass surgery. He got relief. They have not even gone to the chest. Okay?
Placebo. Thank you, sir.
Sir, here.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is
Good Mylin. Afternoon, ma.
My name is Mylin.
What?
Mylin.
Mylin?
Yes.
Mylin Sheath.
No. Actually, I wanted to ask you a question. When you go for a job, for example, the first thing they tell you once you're hired, what you studied, keep it aside and now learn what we are going to teach you. Because generally, our education system, what we learn, for example, in physics, or we are all learning something which was used long ago. And today, what we're using is all nano. So, like, what's the use? Learn what we're currently using. Yes, I know that you need to have a background history of what is learned. But teach what is currently being used. Like, I just don't find it, you know, a connection to it. Like, we are made to learn, give exams on that. But when it comes to our job, it's completely different.
No. When the education system changes, the interviewer also changes. So he will also understand, he or she will understand that the new system takes only this kind of things.
No, for example, if you see the kids today, if you expect a child to pass till the 8th standard, you're passing him to go till the 10th, and then suddenly in 11th and 12th, you want him to know everything about science. Like, how it's possible for a child who's not done basic things in chemistry or physics, and you expect him to know physics, chemistry, even with the concepts what is taught in masters?
No. See, it all depends on how you teach. You can teach, even supposing you're teaching chemistry for the first time in 11th class, you can start from the basics of chemistry and teach, no harm done. But you ask some of the chemistry teachers, they know how to do that.
We lack good teachers at times. We lack good teachers at times because everyone is running to complete the portion.
Oh, for portion be bloom. That's why I said that's the worst part of education. Portion, this, that, bullshit. What is a portion in education? What's the whole thing is a portion. You know, they say, sir, what's the portion in medical college? I said, sky is the limit. Where's the portion? I have not understood a human body even today at this stage. Yes, somebody is asking some questions, but I can't hear the question. Lady Dunn?
Yeah, thank you.
Good girl.
You said, MPI, you know,
DNS, yes.
Yeah. In your lecture, you said, you know, all the medicines are same.
No, all the medicines are same. I didn't say that.
Yeah, I mean, you know,
medicines, all the medicines have faith in heal. Yeah.
No, I just want to know, what is the after effect of Ayurvedic and the English medicine? One of the same?
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's only a question of time.
So there won't be any problem of having, you know, Ayurvedic in case of, you know, English medicine or English medicine.
I told you, which you didn't, you missed the part of this. This is what happens, you know, if you what I said in the beginning is, what is important is to find out what the disease is. Medicine is not important. If you find out what the disease is, and most of the time, you know, the disease corrects itself. Your medicine is only a placebo. You know placebo? In Latin, it means I please. Just to please the mind, to have faith. Okay? Yeah. So it doesn't matter what medicine it is. It's a placebo.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, ma.
My name is Smita Matthew.
Smita.
Yes, sir.
Good name.
Thank you, sir. Well, sir, I've had the privilege of listening to you when you came as a NAC auditor in D.Y. Patil University in 2009.
My God.
I work with them. And one of my former
colleagues... I have forgotten that.
So one of my colleagues is now here, and that's how I'm here. So once again, sir, thank you so much for such a beautiful talk.
Thank you.
Sir, I want to ask...
Was it as good as 2009?
So that was in context to the betterments that you suggested to us as a university, how we could have gone ahead.
Okay.
This is totally different and it has been very engaging. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
So my question to you is, we are a lot of teachers here. You have been a prolific teacher. Okay.
I don't know. Anyway.
I have heard so, sir.
I have been a teacher for half a century. Yes. Okay. Teaching is in my blood.
Okay. So that be so. I would want to know, sir, as a teacher, what are maybe 2 to 3 very essential tips you would like to give the current teachers?
Number one, a teacher is a very good, must be a very good student. Teacher must know the subject as much as possible, because you go to and expose yourself to the students, you should be able to answer questions, number one. Number two, teacher must love his or her students, not in the literal sense of the word, but in the compassionate sense. Number three, teacher must be a good example to students. You can't preach something and practice something else. You know, students look through you as a teacher. I've seen teachers saying in the class, don't smoke and all, and then going to the office room and then smoking there. Then teachers, students see that. You know, a lot of parents who drink at home alcohol, and when the son comes, they say, hey, do your homework, go. That child will have curiosity. He doesn't believe you after that. He will steal some money from your pocket, go to the club and drink. So don't do that. You must be very honest. You must walk your talk. That's the Indian culture. Vakevam krutayevam sajjanam, vakevam krutayevam durjanam. You know what culture is? Culture is not about dancing and literature and all. Culture is what you do when no one looks at you. So if you do something in private, you must do the same thing in public. So you must preach what you practice. Then students will have faith in you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, ma.
Good afternoon.
Where are
sir?
You?
Sir, there.
Doesn't matter. Good afternoon or good morning. Yeah. Because, you know, in the English system, you say good morning when it's the morning. In American system, you say good morning whenever you see a person. In the evening also, you say good morning. For the first time. Go on.
Okay.
Oh, yes, I see you now with the red dufatta. Go on.
Sir, my question was, you just said that it is what you believe. So, regarding the morphine example what you gave. So,
about what?
The morphine, I guess. I don't know. I'm not much science. The
morphine exam, yes.
Yeah. So, I'm so sorry. I just saying, so what if I believe that something doesn't harm me? Will it not harm me then?
If you believe strongly that it doesn't harm you, it doesn't harm you. Certainly not. Definitely not.
So, I overthink a lot. So, that means if I think it's not harming me, I'm just overthinking. So
that's right. But don't overthink. You must believe. not just think. Thinking is different from believing.
Yes, sir. Thank
okay?
you. Okay? Yeah, thank you, sir.
Good girl. Done? Yes, sir. No, no, you sit and talk. Doesn't matter. You put exactly my words into my mouth.
Okay.
Medicine is a business. Heart attack does not come by blocks in the coronary vessels. No.
Okay.
The two are not connected at all. Heart attack comes when your mind is bad. So if you can mind your mind, you can avoid your heart attack to a great extent. Your all four vessels can be blocked. Nothing happens because the vessels were not blocked yesterday. When the doctor frightens you, 100% block of a vessel, it didn't happen yesterday. It happened over the last 25 years. And when the vessel started getting blocked, nature provided bypass. And if you carefully look at the angiogram, you will see a lot of God-given bypass for you. And they are called collaterals. You don't have to worry. They are much better than others because then your heart gets learns to learn to live with less blood supply. That is why I always say it is better to have blocks in the heart, in the coronary vessels. Yes, you said rightly. It is business. It's not a small business. It's a big business.
Most of medicine is a business today, actually. Then.
You are right. Actually, in the corporate culture, if you don't do business, you are not there as a doctor.
You are
thrown out.
Targets. You have
yes,
targets.
Yes. Medicine is a business.
Thank
and
you.
Corporate hospitals are a business. You know, medicine was so bad in 1823 that a thinking doctor started a science journal called The Lancet. He said, I will call it a Lancet because the doctors have become an abscess on the human body. I'm going to cut it and excise and take the pus out. And he did it when 1823. The journal lasted 185 years now. Very famous journal. The present editor said, what has happened to medicine since the Lancet started? So he called Hilary Butler, a historian, medical historian, to study this. She took 2 years to study, and what she wrote at the end was, what was once a bunch of bad doctors in London has now transformed itself into a corporate monstrosity all over the world, killing people left, right, and center. That's medicine.
Thank you, sir.
If it is not a business, it doesn't exist. Yes, madam. No, sit down. Please sit down.
No, sir. It's okay.
Please, for heaven's sake.
Oh, absolutely fine. Good morning, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, good morning.
I just want to ask one thing. Just you said medicine is a business. I have gone through an experience that last year, two years back, I had some severe back pain. Okay, I had been to one very good hospital, like you can say 5-star hospital, and then after my MRI and X-rays and all, the doctor said, you have to do the operation for that. You have to undergo the surgery.
My God, you didn't have it?
No, I didn't
good
have it.
Good, you didn't have it.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you would have been in bed.
Yeah,
now.
Yeah. So, and he said he had given me that 8 hours operation and all. But I went to some another person, like, and then I just wanted to find out, you know, like second opinion. And then doctor, he asked me to do certain exercises. I have done that. And then he said, no need. Okay, of doing
any another
operation.
Doctor or the same
yeah.
doctor?
No, another doctor. Another doctor,
doctor,
yeah. Another 5-star hospital.
He's a good doctor.
Very good doctor.
Yeah.
He was the spine surgeon there and the last authority, it seems. So somebody had given me that reference and I had been there. So, and again, this year, some problem I had gone to another regular orthopedics doctor, not to the you can say that so-called
third doctor.
Okay. And that third doctor also said no need of operation. How can that person, that doctor had suggested this? Okay. So this is the story. Now I just want to know that since you are such a great person, I just
want to know. No, I'm a human being.
No, sir. Can a patient has got that right to ask before slipping on the operation table? That I just want to know that exactly what had happened. Is any rule is there in your medical ethics or in our law system? I just want to know because this had happened for many people, even angiography, angioplasty. So many people, they are suffering through this. As you said, medicine is nothing but business. So as a common people, rather human beings, do we have any that kind of system that we can just go and find out whether this operation is needed, whether really there is a blockage, or Or again, we'll flow in the stream. I really want to
find
out.
It's a good question. I'll give you a very simple solution as a patient. Yeah. Number one, never submit yourself to surgery on one opinion. Okay. Take a second opinion. Because medicine you can take. If something goes wrong, you can survive. Yeah. But surgery, if supposing they had operated on your back, you would have lost your power in the limbs permanently. I have a doctor who went for this kind of a surgery because I always say never go for back surgery. And he's completely paralyzed now. He's in bed. And poor chap has no wife also, so he's in real trouble. He was my old student, but he's in real deep trouble now. Now, the other thing I would like to say, when you have a backache, never see a doctor. See a physiotherapist. He will cure you with simple physiotherapy. I'll give you an example. I had a patient in Chennai who came to see me with the backache. I said, this man requires a physiotherapist. I called the physiotherapist and said, examine him. He went, came back and told me, sir, I told him to remove his thick purse from his back pocket. His pain is gone, sir. If you have a thick purse at the back, when you sit, it presses on your sciatic nerve. So you get a back pain completely. And if the purse is removed, the pain gone. So you must have a sensible doctor. Yes. Never subject yourself to surgery, any kind of surgery, with one opinion. But they'll trick you. What they'll tell is, supposing you say, I don't want an angioplasty now, the surgery done, I'll go and take a second opinion. He says, I don't know, I can't guarantee. You go to the next place, you will die on the way. Oh. Which is all not true.
That's
not true at all. Yeah. You can always take a second opinion.
So that's the psychology, no? Like we feel it is emergency and then again we have been
cheated. If we don't use the psychology, we can't make you a bakra of you.
Okay, yeah, that's also true.
I'll tell you, one of my students, a very good student of mine, passed his MD and joined a 5-star corporate hospital. One day he was seeing a patient in the OP. So he was trying to tell the patient something. Then the cardiac surgeon was passing by. So he called him, come out, I want to talk to you. He went out. He said, see, in a corporate hospital, this is what you do. If when the patient comes, find out who is funding him, whether he has insurance, whether he's got rich parents, whether he has a lot of money. In that case, you refer him to me. I will manage him. Oh. Supposing he doesn't have anything, then you give him whatever you do and send him off. It requires medicines only. So you have to intervene to make money. And we have to make a bakra of you by putting fear into your head, saying that your vessels are all blocked. I am happy that vessels are blocked. If somebody's vessels are blocked, he'll live long. Oh. I have a chap who came to me 40 years ago with all the 4 vessels blocked in the heart. But so much collaterals he had, his whole angiogram was looking like collaterals. So he came to me. I told him, you don't require anything. You forget about it. And you go home and enjoy life. But his children thought, this village doctor doesn't know. So they were all in America. They took him to America. They took the same angiogram, took him to Mayo Clinic. The Mayo Clinic doctor saw that and said, ask your father to go home, have a peg of whiskey every night, and enjoy life. Oh. And now he is 94. 94. Oh. He's still alive. 54 years later. Absolutely fine with all the vessels blocked. Nature is a great doctor. Nature does all the things. And backache for a woman should never go to a doctor. Backache is due to bad posture. Sit straight. All right.
Thank you, sir.
Don't slouch in the chair. Yeah. That's what most of us do. Even I do that. My son says, you advise everybody, but you slouch in the chair.
Thank
Singh
you.
Singh Sab sat now. Sit straight up. Back straight, and when your back is straight, your back is no problem.
Thank you so much.
Welcome. Good afternoon. Yes, young man. Tell me.
You believe that our education system is flawed, and I'm a frustrated student, so I believe the same, but... but then, if it's such a big system, how do you think it will change? Like.
Thank you very much. It's a good thing. He thought there is a shortcut. He is a frustrated student. So, I'll give him a solution. As long as the system persists, you have to go through the system and pass your exam, because if you don't have a degree, nobody bothers about you. But you are right, that degree is useless, as somebody said. But then you have to have a degree to be somebody. Supposing you talk without having a degree, nobody bothers about you. Supposing I had said this without any one of my qualifications, you would have been laughing at me. Now that I say that, you say, okay, this ass must be knowing something, so he's talking. So have a degree first. Till that time, don't talk. Suffer. Even in the frustrated system. Okay?
Actually, that's not satisfying, actually. Because
you are suffering.
Yeah.
I'm happy.
So, okay, if I'm still pursuing for a degree, I'm funding the system and it's again growing. So that's not right either.
No, you are helping the system as long as the system exists. You can't change the system alone. You know, the system has to change on its own. And we are trying to change the system if possible. We are trying to educate people like Rajshekaran Pillai and others so that the system gradually changes, eventually. You don't do it without your degree. Don't come to Somaiya College and be a BA student and say, I want the system to change. It will change. It will change. Okay?
Thank
Good
you.
Good boy. Anganeya? Sharichaya? Okay. Yes, we'll call it a day.
One more.
One more. Okay. Last question. Okay? Last question by this young lady. Young man. These days it's difficult to say whether it's a man or a woman because they both dress alike.
So you don't see the beard?
No, I see the beard today. Yes. That's why some of us grow the beard. Just to make sure that we are men. Yes, go on.
Okay. So it was really a very nice lecture and I really follow you on YouTube and all.
Thank
so
you.
I just wanted to extend the experience of the back pain that she mentioned. My mother had a similar experience of back pain and she was in excruciating pain. Okay, so when we obviously went to the 5-star hospital and the doctor scared us because I had to take her to the wheelchair and to take her to the hospital. So she was in tremendous pain. And
if she had seen a physiotherapist, she would have been walking back.
Yeah. So he obviously suggested for immediate surgery and don't spend more time because she doesn't have much time. You'll have to do it as soon as possible. And obviously we were against having a back surgery. We took second opinion and then finally, after discussions and we went to a homeopathic doctor and then we went to some other people who suggested don't worry about anything. Just let her sleep on a plywood, on a bed, on a hard flat
hard
surface
bed.
And she will be fine. And now she's perfectly
fine.
Yeah.
Thank
yeah.
you for that. Yeah, yeah. You saved your mother's back.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you so much. So I just wanted to share that and I'm really thankful for this session. Thank you so much.
So, can I ask you a last question?
Yes, young lady, come here, come forward. This is the last question for sure. Where are you? Okay.
Sir, I have a student who is very good in studies, but sometimes when she gets angry, she don't consider anyone who is there in front of her. And she used to beat her mother and who
beat her mother?
Yeah.
My God.
And she throw the things which is there. So how to control such students?
No, thank you. You must consult a psychologist, number one. Number two, anger, you must know, and danger are very close to each other. One letter only. You add D in front of anger, it becomes danger. So anger is always danger.
Yeah.
So you must consult a good psychologist to counsel her. Poor thing, next time won't beat her mother.
Okay.
Unless the mother has been beating her unnecessarily when she was a child.
Yeah.
She wants to give it back to her in the same coin.
Yes, yes, yes. Okay.
Pari, tell us. Yes. Anything else?
Sir, second question I want to ask you. Sir, recently I finished my internship and the most problem that I faced is that whenever I used to enter in the class, the students sometimes they get very active or they are out of control as they see the new face in the class and they used to cross the fine line between the student and the teacher and they used to get very free. So how to handle that situation?
No, you must see, you must learn to handle this over. It won't come overnight. You can't teach that. You must know how to control your students. Number one, as I told you, the simple thing is, you must be very good in your subject. So yes, they respect you. Next time you enter the class, they stand up. You should be able to command respect from the students, not demand. If you go to the class and say, you must all stand up when I come in, that's called demanding respect. Nobody will respect you. So command respect, number one. Number two, love your students. And number three, think that students always have some, you know, idiosyncrasies. So they're not all a set of robots like our education system wants us to be. No, we are human beings. So we have our idiosyncrasies. That's okay. Why are you worried about what the students do? You ignore them. Okay? Theek hai. Good night. Good luck.
Thank you.
Goodbye.
Sir.